Now, you've heard some examples of why this society needs to not only be established, but to move forward. There's so many avenues in which your help and your talents, your drive and your passion is needed. And we're hoping that all of you find merit in what has been said today, and that you will let us know through the forms that you were given, excuse me, what areas you think you would be if that blue form that Gil is holding up. Leave that with us so that we can know what to do, what to make better, how to take advantage of what you have, what talents you have, and what visions you have. We have with us today Iriana with an R, Iriana, Patricia Luna Lozada, who is the Associated Student President, is it, of San Jose City College. She's a DACA student. She's the Deferred Action on Childhood Admission.
Thank you.
I would like to add 30 seconds to her introduction. I have neighbors over this fence, and I always heard these Mexican people talking back and forth, and baptisms, quinceañeras, whatever. They would call us and invite us because they were going to stay up late. And then I've been, so for years I've seen this old, the oldest girl growing up. And I'm, anyway, one day I saw her wearing a Stanford t-shirt, and I said, yeah, right. I talked to her. I said, what do you want to do? She says, I want to go to college. She says, I said, what's your major? She said, chemistry. I said, holy moly. Next time I saw her, I saw her at the Raza round table, and I said, hi, how are you doing? I said, what are you majoring in now? She says, I'm pre-med. And so I thought she was a mere human. She's the Associate Student Body President at San Jose City College and a DACA student.
So before I ran for election, I didn't know that my position would have such power that it does. So when the election happened, I had a lot of students at my office asking me what was going to happen with regards to their schooling and their education. There was a lot of fear throughout the students. And at that moment, I myself, and it's not something that everyone knows that I'm a DACA recipient, and at that moment I had to kind of tell them not to worry about it, and that I would work with the administrators and everyone to ensure that they would be safe on campus, and with the same worries and fears that they have. A lot of students are worried currently with the privacy of their information, because as we all know, the college students give all of our information to the colleges, and with talk about that they want to subpoena information from DACA recipients or AB 540 students. So it was a lot of worry and fear with regards to jobs after college or during college to pay for school. And with all these struggles I saw within our students and myself, we were kind of in a place where we didn't know where to go with all of this. But the campus reassured us that they would not be working with immigration and doing anything that would harm the students. So they passed a resolution probably like a month ago, ensuring that they are in full support of DACA recipients and any students that are vulnerable under this administration. They want to continue the program with the AB 540, you know, and not roll that back. And they also said that they would be supporting if there were to come to it and the Trump administration wanted to roll back DACA, that they, as a college, would help, you know, gather lawyers and see where they could take a stance with that. The other important thing that happened with the students was that our chancellor for the community colleges throughout all of California also sent out a letter to our chancellors saying that they are in favor of DACA students and that they support the students and the colleges should ensure that they are safe. So we started seeing that there's a lot of support from the college system throughout California, the UCs, the CSUs, there was a lot of messages coming towards us. And I think it's important that our students are aware that we have this and that the college campus, because they, when they come to school, it's not something that they should be fearing. They shouldn't be fearing to come to school because the police might work with ICE or anything like that. So we're doing our best to try to promote that throughout throughout our students. And currently, we're also rearranging how the student government positions work. so that we can have a dedicated person who's in charge of anything were to come, that they'll be able to focus on that and make sure that, work with administrators to ensure that our students are safe. And I think it's also important, the more that I've been, I guess now it's been a semester, I think it's important that students like myself who are DACA recipients start taking leadership roles and are given kind of the opportunity. Because then, friends who know me, they were presidents of clubs and all this, and the fear started coming. And when they see me, you know, still try to calm down and, you know, try to continue with our education, I think it gives them a sense of hope too, to see us and to also create a community that we're there for them and we're all here for each other. So currently we're trying to create a safe space. So we did a political climate kind of forum with the president of the college and myself and other faculty. So it's things like this where workshops are held to the students so that they could attend and they could, any fears that they have are addressed. So the other thing too, there are different organizations that help students in education. For example, when I decided to become a doctor, one of the organizations I was connected to was PhD Dreamers. So no, they don't only work with MDs, but they also work with any students that are trying to get into a graduate program and help them. A lot of them have been getting more and more popular on television and stuff because they are doing a lot of advocacy at higher levels and with grad schools and all these other professional schools. So I, the other thing we're hosting is Know Your Rights workshops on campus, so the students don't have to go off-site to go find these workshops. They're being provided on campus. And I think it's important that we continue this work and that we continue to encourage our students to take lead in this work, because it will also subside their fear. They'll feel like they have the voice to come and change things, and I think it's really important. So. Yeah.
Thank you. With our young people coming up, we should be in good shape. We'll give you all the opportunity we can to let you speak. I wanted to, before I wrap this up, I wanted to let you know something about the power of the Border Patrol. Border Patrol has almost unlimited power. It says it has search authority, which extends 100 miles from the border. You can stop and question people at fixed checkpoints, can pull over motorists that are suspected of a crime as part of a roving patrol, border patrol operation. Ambiguity over electronic devices has resulted in searches of cell phones and the laptop contents. The Fourth Amendment against unreasonable searches and seizures is lessened at the port of entry, and they can seize your property. They can, without a warrant, inspect anyone entering the country and their belongings, and can question citizenship and immigration status, and ask for documents to prove admissibility to the United States. No body cavity searches, thank God for that, need some level of suspicion that a person is engaged in illegal activity with a supervisor's sign-off, and they can seize any electronic device, copy information on it for a reasonable period of time, could be for 5 days or more, and they can have travelers turn their devices on and examine the contents, and they don't need a specific suspicion about the traveler. So the Border Patrol, like I said, is part of the part of justice. They have power to put you in jail. They have prisons in which so many of our people are kept there. They
and
say
as
that
part of the executive order, it's been extended to the whole country. It is no longer the first 100 miles along the border. And how many of you are walking around with work proof that you are U.S. citizen?
Not many, I can tell you that, but I can tell you this too, that
there's
reason for that fear that Teresa mentioned, because it is real. There's reason for that fear that Iriana mentioned, because it's real. We have it on the books, and this guy that we have in the presidential office now has no idea who we are, why we have that fear. All he knows is, if this is the law, let's do it. There's no way around that. Now, they said that religion doesn't matter. Muhammad Ali's son and Muhammad Ali's widow were stopped in Miami. The first thing they asked him is, what religion are you? Mm. But the guy said, do you know who Muhammad Ali was? And the guy said, no. What religion are you? He said, why does that matter? I mean, they got into a little argument there, but there is a lot of reason for it. We've reached the end of our formal presentation. I wanted to make sure that you remembered. Well, we're going to have a question and answers. So, people, Elena, where's Elena?
She had to leave. She had to leave.
Oh, she left? Did she give you the question?
She may have right here. Let me see.
Okay. Anyway, the idea here is if you need to leave, be sure you leave the blue sheet filled out and leave it behind so we can contact you for our next gathering. If each of you has a lot to say, well, stick around and we'll stay here as long as you need.
Carl.
And Carl Soltero, anyone who has a question, the formal part of it is ended. I want to thank you for attending this meeting today. Ramon, you have something?
My question is right there on the back
sheet. Okay.
Go ahead.
No, are you going to say something?
Yeah, I was just going to say, we need the blue sheet. We need you to say what did and didn't happen. Every one of you should have 15 minutes today to say something. Every one of you has a big, big, you're all resources. That's why you're here. That's why you're here. So leave it on the sheet. We will get back. You know we have to meet again. Last, I need somebody who can make an Excel database of all this so we can then send everyone's address to everybody. Okay? Without someone who knows how to do the Excel, you're not going to get it. Very quickly. We need help. Thank you.
There's membership information there. There's, of course, you can have money to run any operation. So there are dues that are asked of you. They're tax exempt. You can declare them on your income taxes. We need your help. We can't do this just on a string. We can't do it just because we're good people. We need help. Carl.
Yes, sir. Pardon me, I wasn't on the agenda. I should have made sure I got under, but I just wanted to share with everybody the project that I'm working on currently. Thanks to Ramon's encouragement, I was appointed to the Santa Clara County Commission to have this area declared a National Heritage Area. That process started last May, so we're going coming up on a year. And I mean, I have to be very honest with everybody. Initially, I was just amazed, flabbergasted, whatever term you want to use, the profound lack of knowledge by, shall we say, the dominant culture has about our history. Echoing what Teresa Teresa said, how for the last 50, 60 years we've been involved in so many civil rights activities that have made this valley a more better place for all immigrants across all over the world to come here. I just want to say that initially, as I said, the profound lack of knowledge on the part of these people. I've literally gone to their homes and given them a lecture, given them a list of names. I've consulted with Ramon, who's consulted with the person who's doing the proposal, John G. I myself have given him some consultations. We have our history in the proposal now. Becoming part of a National Heritage Area allows us to link to any potential funding sources. Of course, with the present administration, there's no guarantee of that with the cutbacks to the national endowments and things like that. But nevertheless, once the area is declared a National Heritage Area, it would allow our historical society to become linked to that process, hopefully get some funding for our future projects. Number two, KKUP, with Ramon's encouragement, I taped some one-minute blurbs on our heroes and heroines. I'm not sure when that will come on air, but if you go to KQP, I'm sure it'll show that. Ramon gave me some suggestions, but I don't know why I was drawn to the idea of the women warriors that represented us in terms of civil rights. So I did 1 minute blurbs on Sofia Mendoza, of course, Ernestina Garcia, Shirley Trevino, Rachel Silva, a person a lot of us don't even know about, and my good buddy Consuelo Rodriguez. So 1 minute blurbs on each one of these women warriors of La Causa. So that's going to come out on the radio. So I just wanted to say that, and I want to thank all the board, especially Ramon, for all the hard work he's done in getting this together.
Carl has just said the radio station KLIV has asked for just a second, a minute, like what he just did on the radio on KKUP. To do it on KLIV. I have a list of all of the emails that I've received so far from Ramon, and I'm going to send out to you a request to give me a brief biographical sketch, maybe one page, about you, why, following that format that was in the newspaper, why we should know about you, what have you done, what are your objectives, and what do you want to do? And I'll be the guy on the radio for a minute, talking a little bit about each of our people in our community. And I'm meeting with Bob Key, the owner of the KLIV, on Monday for lunch to see how he wants to do that. But in advance of that, I put together the emails of a lot of people that I know here. Carl, just to follow up on you, I could use those that you've already done, and maybe we put them in writing, and I can put them into the general KLIV. Okay. Now, Consuelo, you had a question.
Statements. When a person did the presentation on Galarza, I just wanted to share that those steps that they talked about, what's really important is that those steps represent his philosophy, in that he was trying to unite his philosophy of the university with the community.
You mean the walkway?
The walk steps that we say he's quoted, and there are those steps. And he purposely, the reason the committee did it was Dr. Castro. We were on the committee that organized that and got that taken care of, and we wanted to address his philosophy that universities tend to be out in utopia and they don't communicate with the university, and that's exactly what those steps address. So please keep that in mind. The other thing is that I have a picture, somebody talked about the cannery workers, and I have a picture of my Nina in 1930s at the cannery worker, joined the Red, volunteered and instigated the Red Cross at the Richmond Chase Cannery. We're talking about 1930s. Tomorrow, Cesar Chavez Walk starts at Roosevelt Park at 11 o'clock, and we're marching from Roosevelt to St. James. Also, we now have the first Chicano appointed as the Department of Education superintendent for the state of California.
Thank you, Fernando. I was just handed a check from my friend Eugene Flemante. Went to school with his aunt. He just gave us a donation, $100, putting his money where his mouth is. Stand up, Eugene. You're our hero. Come on, stand up.
He's also Sophie Mendoza's attorney.
Give him another burrito.
Thank you, Jean. And of course, this is mother's milk of politics. It's the mother's milk of nonprofit organizations, because without it, not much can be done. It costs money to print these brochures. It costs money to do all this stuff. You heard how much Bert thought it was going to cost to digitize all of the El Excentrico magazine. Well, that's why we need to help from places like San Jose State University Library, because they can do that. We aren't able to put that kind of money together just yet. But we do need your help as much as you can give, knowing full well that it's going to what I think is a meritorious objective of this society. So I want to open it up. It's, like I said, the formal part is over. Now we can open it up for questions. We have one question over there, and then we go to Gil.
I don't have a question. I just have, like, I want to thank Consuelo for inviting me, and I've enjoyed everybody talking and the history. I also want to say I'm the new Chicano commencement advisor at San Jose State, so I'm going to be contacting a lot of you guys. I haven't gone around to it because building the program from where it started has been a whole issue. But I'm excited because I've learned it has a lot of history. So if any of you guys have any history you want to share, if you guys want to be speakers, I'm going to start getting my speakers ready for my next 2018 class, which will start next semester. So please contact me, or you'll be hearing from me. Eventually, I also want to make an endowment for them. So,
what's your name?
Claudia Tercero.
And what's your position?
I work at San Jose State in the development office, which I think is also great. So we know fundraising stuff.
Flavia, if we gave you the list of all these names and you put it on a database, you'd have the whole database. Is that a good deal?
Yeah.
You got it. You can call us and let us know if you want speakers. because all of us have something to say and have to say.
Mm-hmm.
I had a question here that was given to me by Benny. This is for Teresa Castellan. Would you recommend people to apply or to continue the process for U.S. citizenship at this time?
Oh, yes. The vote is the most important thing that we have at this point. And the only way to really protect yourself as an immigrant is by becoming a citizen. So for people to take that step.
The fear is that would alert,
that puts them on a list.
That would put them on sort of a list.
Well, they're already legal permanent residents. I certainly know where they're at. The thing about the way the law is made up, and this has happened under Clinton, is that if you are an immigrant and make a mistake, you can get deported anytime. If you are a U.S. citizen, that's the only way you cannot get deported.
No, but I mean, that doesn't alert them that you're applying, that you know.
You can apply. We have the right to become citizens. So people should apply. We have a free citizenship day on April 8th at San Jose City College. That means the application will be filled out for free. And one of the last things that the Obama administration did was create three tiers of payment for the application. So it raised it to, I think, $785. But now there's a $400 fee if you make a certain income, and there's a waiver for another if you make another income.
So
there's three levels of fees to apply for citizenship, and that will be all covered on April 8th at City College.
I think the clarification is what Betty perhaps may be asking is that you're talking about people who are already here with some sort of paperwork.
Yes.
And then they're applying for citizenship as opposed to people with zero paperwork.
No, you can only apply for citizenship if you're a legal permanent resident.
Yeah.
Those are the only people that can apply for citizenship if you have legal permanent residency.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a big list of things that you need to do in order to apply. So minimum, you have to have been here for 5 years as a legal permanent resident, which means immigration knows where you're at. And you have to be able to speak English and have a basic conversation in English and pass a U.S. history test. But that means you were a legal permanent resident. You can't jump from being undocumented to citizenship. That's how it works.
Thank you.
Just a quick note. Even people that know about Ernesto Garza and Cesar Chavez, they don't know enough because I was invited to a meeting downtown to meet at the Chavez table. And I said, what Chavez table? Right next to the Fairmont. There's a big hat there.
Yeah.
And so they got there, but they didn't take the time to read about Ernesto Garza.
Those are the steps that Consuelo's talking about.
Yes.
If you go along the sidewalk from Plaza de Cesar Chavez to San Jose State, along the sidewalk, inscribed on the sidewalk in brass or bronze, are some of his dichos, some of his words, some of his wisdom as it goes all the way down. So it's a nice, large monument. Al, you have a question?
I guess what I'll comment, Fernando, is the fact that this is the largest group that I've seen to attend one of these meetings. And I really like this. And it's people that make the power. And the fact is, it's saying the stars coming, we can double this, we get bigger, I think we can go places. If we need more people to join us, and we can go a long ways.
Okay. That's right. That's why we're encouraging you to give us all the information, ideas, suggestions, criticism that you have.
Actually, California LULAC Convention is going to be coming here to look at the NHU on May the 6th. We need a workshop, and this would be a wonderful workshop that you could present to membership. So this idea would spread not just for here, but go across to Southern California. So I'm hoping that maybe you think, consider making a workshop.
Was it May 6th?
May 6th.
After the Cinco de Mayo?
Here.
Okay. Yes, Darlene.
Oh, I just have two events that I want to invite you to, which is one is Congresswoman Anna Eshoo is going to come talk about the suffragette movement and the 19th Amendment. I think it's always good to hear about our history and how people got things done so that we can do the same. So that's on April 19th at 2 p.m. And I'll send it to Ramon or whatever so you can send it to everybody. And then the second one is speaking to cannery workers. I think did any of you go to the cannery worker talk that they did at the library? Nobody? It was really good, actually. So there's this professor at San Jose State, and she's doing a whole study on all the canneries that were here. And she's going to do a talk on it. Again, it's her, Margo Mc Bane, and Margarita Garcia. And so it's Valley of Hearts Delight, Women of the Canneries. And I don't have the exact date and time for that, but it will be in May, and I'll send you that information too.
Thank you.
And both of those are free to attend.
Academicians can only learn what's there, what's available to them. They don't have access to what you know. They don't have access to what you have at home. I had attended a Cinco de Mayo celebration by the Mexican consulate, and one of the professors at San Jose State, whose name I don't recall, and she did not know about the fiestas de las Rosas, didn't know anything about the riots that took place at that time, had no real understanding of our community. She was just talking about Cinco de Mayo being the recognition of the Pueblo, Batalla de Puebla, and all that stuff, without really understanding what it meant to us here. Yeah. Mora Torres.
Yeah. Talk about history and women. One of the people that has been here for a very long time, very active, been a part of our community, Blanca Alvarado, who came in from Colorado in 1948 and has lived in San Jose for a long time. She's probably one of the most powerful, most influential Mexicana, Chicanas, Mexican-American women. And so I'm inviting you to go to San Jose State on April 28th. You all got a flyer. We're going to be having a dialogue. She's going to be coming in to talk about her life in San Jose, her involvement in many political movements as a member of MAPA, and then eventually when she ran for city council, and obviously the famous town statue controversy. So I invite you all April 28th, Wednesday, at the Student Union. Okay, there's a brand new theater that we're opening up, and she's part of this series that we want to set up called, the Luis Valdez El Machete speaker series. And so last year we brought in Luis Valdez. This is Blanca Alvarado. And we're looking for new ideas also as to who we can invite for next year. So I urge you to come April 28th.
When Blanca Alvarado got elected, the reason she got elected is because prior to that election, city council seats were citywide. Well, none from our community had the resources to campaign throughout the city of San Jose. A colleague of mine, Joaquin, and I'm trying to remember his last name, I'll remember after I leave. Joaquin Avila is a lawyer who fought against that, and so now we have districts for San Jose, and now you have District 5, and Blanca runs for that. She has a hammer and tongs sort of battle with another woman who owned the Marqueta del Valle, and Blanca won. When she started off, she could hardly do any public speaking. She was married to a guy named Jose J. Alvarado, who owned a radio station and was really voluble. But over time, Blanca has become one of our most eloquent speakers, one of our most respected civic leaders. And it wasn't by accident. It was because Joaquin Avila challenged the citywide elections because that historically meant that minorities could never get a representation on the city council. Consuelo, you had another question?
Again, the statements.
More statements.
This young lady that left, I invited her, and she, Darlene, is an Enya. I brought her, she's at San Jose State, and if you don't know what an Enya is, you talk to Darlene, but I invited her, and she has felt excluded from the community, and she filled out the form, and she wants to participate. And that's what we need to do. I'm mentoring her, and she also just got a scholarship to the University of New York.
Wow.
University. But we have to do some fundraising and get some money for her because, you know, she's she's an Indian, meaning she's two cultures.
Thank you.
Darlene can explain.
Thank you. One of the Indians was, it used to be that every year, elephant seals beach at the Año Nuevo State Park, and they go there to birth and to mate, and you have to stay away until they're done, and then you can go see these huge animals coming in. And the newspaper, San Jose Mercury, used to write that. Año Nuevo, A-N-O, And I called up with Jay Harris, the publisher, and said, do you know the difference between an N and an Inye? He said, well, is that one with a little curly thing? I said, yeah, that's a different letter. It's like an L or a P or an R. It's a different letter, it's not an N. Because Ano Nuevo means a new anus. Ano Nuevo means new year. Really? And ever since then, I've noticed they all print Ano Nuevo. So, more questions over here.
So what she's referring to, Enya, is a little bit different. it's this female filmmaker that I just hosted, I think a couple of years ago.
She's with Casa Q.
And she did a documentary, and it's E-N-Y-E, so she spells Enya out, okay? And it's about Latinos who grow up in two worlds. Like, say we grow up and a lot of your children have grown up that don't know English, and so are they really Latino because they don't know English?
They mean it in Spanish. Yeah.
They don't know Spanish. Right. Are they Latino because they don't know Spanish? Or they, you know what I mean? So it's like, we're really American, but we're kind of Latino. And then even this, I'm gonna do one criticism. I don't know if it's a criticism, but I should say it doesn't. Like, the term La Raza for me is a very old-fashioned term. I don't associate with that. Me and my, and I'm not that young either. I'd like to think I am, but that's a very old-fashioned term for me because that was the Chicano era or whatever, and that's not an era that I grew up in. So just the name alone is very old-fashioned.
I can talk about that. I'm the guy that argued this when I was president of La Raza National Lawyers Association. Jean Flemate is president, or was president last year, of La Raza National Lawyers Association here in Santa Clara Valley. La Raza is intended to be all-encompassing of anyone, everywhere, of any race who happens to identify with Latin America, Mexico, South America, Spain, the Philippines. If they speak Spanish or they are identified by language, they are included as La Raza. There is La Raza.
When was La Raza Lawyer Association founded, though? What year?
Oh, that was in, let's see, I was president in 1977. It was formed in 1978.
It goes to Europe?
No, let me finish. It was coined earlier in the 1900s by a Mexican writer. But it refers to, it's a short term for La Raza Cosmica. The cosmic race that was the combination of the white, the black, the yellow, and the brown to come up with this positive aspect of our people, no matter what their race is, now they're called Raza. From Tijuana down to Tierra del Fuego, they don't celebrate Christopher Columbus's Day. They celebrate el Día de la Raza. Even Giuseppe Verdi in his opera Rigoletto refers to his people as una raza dannata, a damned people, because they were the ones that caused the death of his daughter. So raza is unknown, and for people that are young, like Darlene, they associate that with the Chicano activist movement, militant movement of that period. But that's only because they arrogated that name to themselves, but it's not because it was a negative. The negative comes from people who didn't associate or identify with what they were doing or promoting. But the term raza is intended to be all inclusive of all of us people, whether they are Inyas or not.
I'm not criticizing that.
No, I'm
just saying for marketing purposes, it doesn't relate to younger people. That's what I'm saying.
And I understand. So it's our job to correct that, because you're a marketing executive. You know about marketing. You know what will resonate. And we have an asterisk to our title, of the Raza Historical Society, that tells exactly what I just said, because we want people to understand this is not a negative. National Consejo de la Raza, nobody says that's antiquated or bad. It's the most powerful Latino organization in the country, and they attract millions and millions of dollars from advertisers everywhere. Yes, ma'am.
I actually used to work for NCLR, and we used to get a lot of calls about that, but there is a description on the website that really talks about the
whole cosmic.
It goes even further.
They probably didn't hear you in the back.
Yeah.
But you stand and let them know where.
So I used to work for NCLR a few years ago, National Council of La Raza, and so we did actually get a lot of questions about that. And on the website, you could actually find even a further explanation, which is encompasses what he just said, but also talks about being la gente debajo de las estrellas, you know, el cosmico, the whole thing. So it's actually really nice. You can share it from there.
Yeah. Some more questions?
I'd just like to make a statement.
Stand up so they can hear you.
Yes, please.
Please.
You know, I belong to PAC, which is associated with PICO. It's a national community organization. And last Saturday, there were 1,500 of us that went to Sacramento to support, to talk to our congressman to support all these bills that are for the immigration. It was a really beautiful assembly. We walked down, you know, the Capitol with banners and everything promoting, you know, our rights. And I think PICO and PAC have really done a lot of work on the immigration, you know, problem. And, of course, you also know Father John Pettigo, who's a really big, you know, speaker for this movement.
Thank you.
Also, I just wanted to ask, I guess, Mario, do you have the first edition of El Excéntrico?
Yes.
You do? Okay. And that's how I wanted to know.
For $100, you can look at it.
Okay.
PAC is People Acting in Community Together, but it's made up of not just people, Raza, it's made up of everyone who has children in schools and they want to be active in making sure that the schools are better for their children, making sure that their neighborhoods are better for the community. So it's more than just Raza that goes into PAC or PICO, but we're a microcosm of that. Yes, Marcy?
I want to say too, and like her, when we were doing the Coronelas, there was another group of girls, ladies, and they called themselves que eran la Raza. And they tried to hit us in one of our parades. Because they say, you guys are Mexicanas, we're Raza. And I said, well, what? You know, so it took me a long time to understand also that, and now the explanation, now that, and there's a few others here.
That's why education is so valuable, because it can erase misconceptions and misunderstandings, and can open our eyes to the potential that we have.
Thank you.
Ramon.
I wanted to clarify my joke. The first edition, every single page of El Excéntrico, and the last edition are already on a DVD, we're going to tell you, buy it for $10. And every $10 you donate, we'll give that to schools or wherever you want to give it. But they're already digitized.
All right, any more questions? Anybody has any ideas, suggestions, criticisms? Another contribution with Lilia Tenes and Rudy Tenes. Thank you very much. Although he's retired 87 years of age, he's still going strong. Last night was his birthday.
Happy birthday.
No, actually, today is his real
today?
Birthday.
Son
las mañanitas que cantaba el rey David. A los días de ni bien despierta, mira que ya amaneció. Ya los pajarillos cantan, la luna ya se metió.
Sí, now that means your Raza. Don't forget these forms. Please fill them out. Please let us know what interests you have. Please contribute as much as you can, and as often as you can, wherever you can.
Please,
thank you for coming.
Clean up. Please clean up. We have no custodian, and this poor teacher's going to walk into class Monday morning, and it's going to be all messed up. So please clean up. Send all this material forward. Everything in the plastic envelopes, please.
I know he's very, very
good.
I want to make sure I have his attention. When we do this,
did you hand it in? Why not?
Hey.
I hear something.